I'm Lisa Fishman. I'm director of the Davis Museum. I'm so pleased to see you all here. Welcome to Wellesley. We have the great pleasure today of spending some time with Radcliffe Bailey and with the curator of the exhibition, Carol Thompson. We're going to have a little bit of an unusual format. So first, we're going to ask Radcliffe to speak about his work, and then we're going to gather together to have a little bit more of an open conversation, during which time we'll have questions. It's a really huge treat to have Radcliffe here again, in part because he's been spending some time in the studio working on a lithograph in advance of a program that we have this Saturday called French and American Lithography, History and Practice. It's a day-long symposium. We're going to be working with our partners at the American Antiquarian Society to bring new scholarship and new attention to the long history of French and American relationship around lithography. And Radcliffe has generously spent some time working in the studio on a lithostone so that we have a contemporary tie-in to a more historical program that we have planned. There'll be a demo in the afternoon and all sorts of talks, and it should be a very lively, very fun, very interesting day. So I'll encourage you to pick up one of these programs that are over in the lobby of the Davis Museum after our evening here. The exhibition catalog that accompanies this work, Radcliffe Bailey, Memory as Medicine, is a gorgeous, beautifully illustrated, beautifully written publication. But what it doesn't give so much is the sense of the artist's own voice. And again, we are very lucky to have Radcliffe here with us. It's an incredibly special thing to spend time with an artist around the production and execution of an exhibition, but to have a little extra time once the show is up and people have seen it and it's kind of settled into its place. Well, it's really been a very nice couple of days. So I hope you will join me in welcoming Radcliffe Bailey, in thanking all of our sponsors who've made this exhibition possible, including the Friends of Art, who are so generous in terms of their support for the Davis. And here I will. There we go. Welcome, Radcliffe Bailey.
I've known Lisa probably, how many years have we known each other?
Oh, well.
What? For a minute.
Yeah.
And it's always nice to be able to work with friends, especially when you're working with something that's personal to you. I think as an artist myself, I think I started making art because of my insecurities. And I've always felt as if I could hide behind my work. And today, it's like, it's weird because I'm doing my work, but now I have to speak in front of people. I hate it. I hate it, but I have to learn to like it, and I love it. These are photographs that were given to me by my grandmother, and my grandmother gave them to me, I guess, like, I remember I was in college, and I was trying to figure out direction with my work and trying to find a direction, something that made sense to me. And I didn't really know exactly which way to go, but my grandmother, I remember one Christmas, my grandmother, my mom, her sisters, they were all sitting at the table. It was late at night, and basically they traveled from New Jersey to Virginia, and we traveled from Atlanta to Virginia. And basically my grandmother, while I would sit at the table as a kid and doodle, my grandmother went in the back and she pulled out this old album and she gave it to me. But the thing about it, my grandmother didn't really know my work. But she gave it to me at a moment when I was at somewhat of a crossroads between trying to figure out directions with my work. And so what I decided was to honor those images of those family members. One of the reasons why it's interesting to go to antique markets and flea markets and see these old photographs. And these old photographs would become discarded, people would buy them, you never know much about them. So we had these old photographs, we had close to maybe 400 photographs in this album. And these are a few of some of the tintypes and some of the things I actually started working with in my work. So I choose to use the ones that we didn't know anything about. Part of the reason why is because they would become discarded. And I use the images, and sometimes the images become like deities to me. You know, there's see some images of females, and they have a strong image that relate to different. I'm gonna go ahead and move on a little. So this is an image of my studio. I kind of work on maybe 20 or 30 things at one time, and you know, I never know when to stop. I choose to stop on the seventh layer. And sometimes it's the seven actual physical layers, or sometimes it's actual seven layers of thought. And so I kind of play back and forth. Seven, why seven? Because I felt like it was a perfect number. But basically, I didn't really study painting when I was in school. I was a sculpture major. And so I only started painting after school because it was easier to move a painting and then to sell a big piece of sculpture. And when I was in school, I was working with working with sound, just different types of objects. And I was doing basically what you do in school is push yourself to a limit. You go out and you get lost in your work. So this is another close-up. Oh, it's okay. No. So you can kind of see, like in the studio, I'm leaving stuff on the ground, and part of it's trying to leave traces and show tracks in terms of my direction, so that tomorrow when I get up, I can start back at it. So, like, I'll give you an example of a layer for me. A layer would be like, there's that funny-looking, mini-looking green that's on the painting. That green was what I remember from that green. Was that my grandfather and my grandmother, I spend those summers and those breaks with them. My grandmother allowed my grandfather to have this one room in the house. This one room in the house, which was his room where he made things. And my grandfather made birdhouses, and he would always say the birds will tell you when the weather changes, and people will too. And so what I did was, whenever I use that mint green, it's a reference to my grandfather. So that's like a layer for me. This is another view of the studio. Yeah, those are my dreadlocks on the paper. I was making paintbrushes out of my dreadlocks at one time. And that's a photograph in the background. It's a photograph that is of a tobacco field where on my grandfather's side of family, they sharecropped Virginia. And that was a photograph that was taken by my grandfather. And that painting in the back is called Uncured Labor. All right, so that was my studio then. That's my studio now. And in the studio now, I just thought I'd try something different and show an image of something recent. But that's a music stand, and it's 10 feet high. So, and it's all about, you know, I've been working with these ideals of music and musicians, as musicians is almost like reference to gods. And you know, when I was in college, I had an opportunity to see Sun Ra. And I saw Sun Ra perform like maybe three or four times. And I was just blown away when Sun Ra would perform, and he would come in late and say that the time on this planet was wrong, and I thought he was an interesting person. So this is a piece called Birmingham to Magic City. And he said he was from Saturn, but he was actually from Birmingham. And so Birmingham to Magic City is a play on, you know, words and magic, perceptions of a black cat to be negative, and these practices in West Africa said to be negative, but I always took them in a positive way. It has BBB on the doors, which is referred to Birmingham Black Barons, which was my first passion, which was baseball. The holes that are drilled along the door refer to this church that's in Savannah, Georgia, was during the Underground Railroad, they were hiding some of the runaway slaves up under the church, and basically for ventilation of the church, because the church was so cool. I mean, to cool the church in the basement was that they drilled holes and holes in these kind of crossroad patterns. And I'm showing some older work, but I'll get to newer work. This is called, this is based on the Birmingham church bombing. And I was commissioned, I wasn't commissioned, I was part of a show that was dealing with the civil rights movement, and this was like 93. And I was doing stuff about the Deacons for Justice and Defense who protect the church by any means with the shotguns. And basically I learned about the incident, and it's not through history books, but I learned about the incident through John Coltrane's music. He had a piece called Birmingham, and it had a effect on me. So I played the song over and over, and I put it on a loop. And so what you hear when you walk in the space was the loop of that sound. So I made a piece out of fire hoses. And so there are fire hoses that run around, but the fire hoses deal with those things used against people, but also the fire hoses for me was representing in another positive light in terms of women and female goddesses and water goddesses. And so I'm using the blue, and blue referred to the blues, but it also refers to the ocean, but different deities. It smells like honey when you come up to the piece, because the piece is painted with encaustic too. And basically I collected materials from, there was this house that was burnt down for a reason because they didn't want these people to move into the neighborhood. So basically I collected the materials from this particular house and made this piece. And it's like the church pews were dealing with church in a way. So sometimes people come and sit down and meditate. But also like it sits on railroad tracks, and it was dealing with the divide between people. This is called Oceanic Beloved, and I'll show some of these images. This was based on my mother being a school teacher and carrying the weight of a lot of kids on top of her. And it's also, in some parts of it, references different parts of West Africa that my curiosity was trying to figure out exactly what part of my DNA, where does it trace to? Because that's something, as an artist, I've always been like curious about in terms of mark making and interest. So there's other things that are in it I won't talk about because I got to get through these. This one's called Mingus Mingus, and it was based on Charles Mingus. And I was thinking if Mingus played baseball, he would play catcher. And so he's this bigger guy, and he's behind home plate. And so basically you have a home plate down at the bottom, and home plate represents to me, that was the position I played when I was in catcher. When I played baseball after school, I played catcher. But during the day, I was in class, and I was sitting back to class because I didn't want to go to the chalkboard. And so I played back and forth between the jazz musicians and the chitlin circuit and the ball players and how they had these relationships. And the neck, the upright, the long neck on it is made out of plow handles based on 40 acres and a mule. Oh, this one's based on Jimi Hendrix, an idea where Jimi Hendrix was putting his guitar on fire. And then it also refers to Lightning Hopkins. There was this house in the fourth ward in Houston where I did an installation with this project called Project Row House. And when I went and did the project, there were all these doors laying around, and basically they sent me maybe 30, 40 doors, and I started rebuilding and constructing the doors in different ways. And the idea was like, you know how Jimi Hendrix puts his guitar on fire, but then also one of the houses there was actually owned by Lightning Hopkins. And so it refers to those blues musicians. Blues musicians talk about crossroads, a house as a place crossing through the door of a crossroads. I did 9 of these paintings, and they're about like 80, 90 inches by 90 or something like that. And I did it on my firstborn, my daughter, when she was born. And I basically took African art and photographed it as if she was coming out of the womb. And so this refers to that, but then also, it's very random. But I think for me, painting's like playing chess. I love to lose because I get more out of losing than I do winning. And so I create problems to solve with on the paintings themselves. So I don't put together colors that make sense sometimes. Like this one. Like, I don't mind. I like the flesh, that pink. I work with that. It was very difficult. But I did like 9 of these paintings just for every month. And this is a piece that was done on, it's called Four Corners, and it's based on Thelonious Monk. But then it's also based on Thelonious Monk, you know, how he'd get up and he'd spin around in a circle and referring to him almost like whirling dervish, but then almost imitating the planets, his middle name, sphere, and then also dealing with quilts and quilt making in the, and then also constellations. The constellations, the white dots are made out of thimbles. And a metrodome, like an old grandfather's clock. This is called Denmark Meets Shango. All right. And so this one is made out of, I don't talk a lot about this one, but I used tobacco, I used rum, and Georgia clay. And then also the axe, that's in there, used to cut tobacco, but when I put it on, it's like a mirror surface. So the mirror surface almost reflected almost as deity named Shango. Shango being like a, amongst the Yoruba, you know, some attributes, or I guess like lightning and things like that, and colors were red and white, and so the Georgia clay worked perfect with that, dealing with sacrifices and blood and Native Americans. I'm bouncing around, but I work on, I think for me, it's become best for me to work on sculpture, painting, and do it all at once. It all relates and it changes, but it's like every painting is like a page, and I'm making this book, and that's how I look at it. This is based on Fela. Yeah, this is the show that I was in, because Fela is one of my favorite musicians. And I also loved, I loved his music, but I loved his, the way he spoke. I mean, as an artist, and I think that he just put the purpose of an artist back in order for me at moments when I'm working and working for a reason. And, you know, reason beyond myself sometimes. This is Black Star Line. I had family members that were Garveyites, and so it's a reference to those family members. Those are photographs of the moon. I go out on a full moon and take pictures of the moon, or go to the ocean, tape record the ocean. It's a combination of a lot of things. I won't go into it. I can get through these images. This is called Southern Crescent, based on the train. It was called the Southern Crescent. Sometimes I think, what's her name, sung a song about the midnight train to Georgia. I think about that a lot when I do this, but Southern Crescent was a train that went from south to north, and my father being a railroad engineer, and it's a combination of my father being a railroad engineer, and we used to catch the Southern Crescent at night, and catch at 7 o'clock at night. We roll into Charlottesville, Virginia around 8 or 9 in the morning, and it refers to that. One of the photographs was a photograph that was one from that family album, but it was all these men on a train, and I couldn't really figure out what the photograph was about. And all these men on a train, and people were saying goodbye to them, and so it was this, either they were going north for work or war. And the question about, you know, African Americans and fighting in wars and battles. And so it's a combination of that, and that's a full moon, but what I do, something also, I go and I take a picture of full moon, but I would imitate my daughter's drawings at the time with the moon because of the shutter stay on too long. This is an installation, it's called Spiritual Migration. It's that green again that my grandfather bought on the wall. I had different bodies of water, but different places in space. I had the Delta, Niger, you know, all these different bodies of water, Mississippi. And I jokingly said that I put water in from the Mississippi inside the bottles. And I remember I had this show. It was in Texas. It was a traveling show. The night of the opening, it rained. You know what? It rained for about 2 weeks. I think it was this time when the floods in Texas. And during my opening, the water came into the gallery and touched the bottles. And the show closed, and they invited me to come back again, but they put me upstairs. So this is another about the railroad and travel. My father, but you know, imitate my daughter's drawings, but I was thinking of migration of music. I had sounds of, in that first room you had sounds of the ocean. You came around this room, you had sounds of trains. You came around this room, you had the smell of tobacco, but then also the sounds of insects on a full moon. Those are like images, and it did a bunch of things for me. This is more like a self-portrait. And it's more so of like a trickster. Trickster, red and black, number three, cigars, rum, twisted roots, machetes. Sometimes somebody can share information, and then sometimes somebody you don't want to cross paths with. So, you know, I think we all have certain sides of ourselves. So this was like the whole installation. I'll go through it. You had the smells of tobacco. These are like medicine cabinets to me. I started making these paintings called, they're based on medicine cabinets. The idea was that whenever you're sick, you go to a medicine cabinet and get something to make you feel good. Well, for me, it was like memory. And so I go into these photographs, and these objects, and these things from the past. So these are not made to be as like paintings as much as they are meant to be open in their cabinets. This is one, it's just based on, I tell you stories rather than being specific about the painting itself. But GWC dealt with George Washington Carver. George Washington Carver, I remember as a kid, my mother taking us on these kind of field trips throughout the South. And I remember going to Tuskegee, and at the time when we went through Tuskegee, that George Washington Carver's lab was set up. And I remember looking through and seeing that. But then also thinking about all the experimentation and experiments he's doing with the peanut, he painted, and thinking about all those things. And when I'm in the studio working, I feel like I'm doing a lot of experimenting too. And sometimes it's experimenting, you see stuff, there's stuff that you play with and you work with, and there's things you don't talk about. And part of that is having a certain level of secrecy within your work and to protect. But so much you can reveal at a certain point. And I deal with the everyday issues in life and things that you question, and I cover it up sometimes with these objects that can relate to people. And I also believe that making things that become so personal that they become universal. And so some of these are like counting the numbers, and it's painted with indigo. It's like a medicine cabinet. It's about 8 inches deep, I think. This is a piano, and it's called Minor. And it's made to be like a fish tank, and you look inside the fish tank, but then I always wanted to go two different places. The deepest ends of the ocean. I wanted to be that guy going down 7 miles. But I want to go out of space, and because they're so similar, and I feel like we sit at a crossroads between those two worlds. This is another studio shot. This is called Bluebird from Seventh Sphere, and Bluebird was dealing with Charlie Parker, I'm sorry. Charlie Parker, Bluebird. But in Atlanta, there's this truck stop. It has this huge, big blue bird. It's probably about the size of the whole screen. And I remember seeing it as I drive by on the expressway. And so what I did was make a replica of it, and so the lights go around. And it's a saxophone in the stomach. I was doing stuff as part of a show that was based on the Black Panthers. And I was doing stuff about the breakfast program that the Panthers had. And then I also was using different objects and symbols. This is called Bird on Bird. And so what's happening is that Charlie Parker's music's playing. There's an African finch inside the cage. On top, up under the African finch, there's sheep music. And so the bird jumps up and chirps to the music and also makes work. And so there's a body of work that it really looks like Pollock, but but there's a body, and that's the bird, and it's, yeah. This one's based on architecture on plantations. I was looking at the African influence on the architecture on plantations, and it's a combination of things. I don't really talk a lot about it. This is called Indigo Pugilist. I was making these things on military blankets. This is called Liberators. Since baseball was my first passion in dealing with that subject, I kind of go back and forth to these subjects a lot. Yeah. The bat's called cleanup. Just like the bat that's here, I needed a bat to beat down all my problems, and so that's what that's for. And this was my baseball jersey, but it's made to look like a hunter's jacket. And a lot of references towards African art, too. This is like Georgia Clay and thinking about, I don't know. I'm trying to figure out a title for this one. I still haven't. All right, so then there's like this trip I made. So I did my DNA and I traced my on my mother's side to Sierra Leone and Guinea. And so I started to think about recovering. So a lot of this is like you see different images of African art going within the boats and dealing with recovering, trying to understand. And nowadays we got DNA, we could trace back to the scene of the crime. And so when I learned about this, this was like the first piece I did, which I basically did a little painting inside a little tintype of a Mende mask. So this is a boat that I made, and it was called Black Redemption. And it was a part of his bait. It's thinking about Marcus Garvey and these boats he had, and they didn't make it, but I think that concept, the ideals, and the thoughts about that live on today, and they make a lot of sense. So that was like, to me, like a boat that's supposed to make it. And this is another boat. And so this is, at the same time, when I was making that boat, my cousin was working on this. And Virginia, where my grandparents were from, he lives there now, and he was making this car. And I was like, hey, I just went to West Africa. I just went, to Senegal, and this is what I'm making. I'm making this boat. And he's like, yeah, I'm making mine. What color should I paint it? We said, we'll paint it black. So that's what that was. So inside the car, there was a video screen playing of a video that me and a group of friends did when we went to Senegal. And I went with a choreographer, and a choreographer named Fatima Robinson. She does a lot of hip hop videos, but then also a musician named Mark Anthony Thomas. And so we worked together and we had similar DNA. And this is a speedboat. The ideal speedboat, you can get there pretty fast, so that's why it's twirling. And so there's a DNA strand that's twirling, breaking up in the back. So I made these are based on the Door No Return. It's a photograph of the ocean, but then it's like a glittery black screen. And the photograph is actually from Cuba. I took the photograph when I went to Cuba and used that. I don't tell anybody that, but it's supposed to just be ocean. It was just pretty. And so what I did was replicate the Door No Return inside the gallery. And there's a video projector that shoots a friend of mine dancing, and she's twirling in a circle, and then all of a sudden she turns into smoke. And so the video shot on top of the screen, and as it moves, it kind of sparkles. So I was making these things that were more like contemporary versions of a tintype. And I wanted to make like these things, and so I print photographs on top of steel. And so that's probably about maybe 3 feet by 2 feet. But yeah, and so I made them. I was thinking about more like family trees. These are things I'm still working on. So all these different ways I'm working, I'm constantly bouncing back into it. I haven't abandoned any of it. I just kind of pick moments to go back into it. And the use of photographs and trying to figure out new ways to do things for endless subject. This is just a mixture of things. So I'm making these lanterns and things right now. I'm still working on this. And I'm sharing some of these ideas and thoughts as I'm working. So this lantern itself, it's probably about maybe yay tall. And what I'm going to do is put insects on the inside of it. And insects from all around the world, and the ideas this person has traveled around the world. So that's what I'm working on now. This is another one where I pretty much printed a photograph on top of a mirror, a translucent mirror. And I still playing with the ideal of that tintype and trying to make that. And that one's probably about maybe five feet, yeah. And so, and that's where some of this image that's upstairs, came from. It started from those ideals and those thoughts. And this one's based on ghosts. And all it is to me, it was like I took a picture with my iPhone of a negative of one of my photographs and put it against the back of my yard, which I live on old Civil War grounds. I put it got back against the back of my yard and photographed with my iPhone. And then I printed it on top of a mirror. This is called Storm at Sea. And so this, you know, Shango, and then thinking about Shango, da-da-da-da, if he was able to cast a storm during the slave trade and the piano keys, and it refers to the music, da-da-da. So it's a combination of all these different thoughts. And, you know, one kind of music, I listen to classical music, I don't know, like maybe 3 or 4 in the morning when I'm working. It's kind of like a soundtrack that I have built going on. And this is called Notes from Elmina, and the Notes from Elmina, I don't know. I was thinking about painful subject matters, but I'm always trying to figure out a way to tell the story and then throw beauty at the same time with a painful subject matter. And it's very difficult, and I think that earlier in my work I was dealing with painful subject matters, but I did not know how to deal with it in a space where to deal with it and get through it and deal with the beauty and the existence of people. So, and these are ones that are, you know, I won't talk about this one, it's Western Currents, but just thinking about all different parts of West Africa, African Americans came from, and then, you know, that search, and so I start using African art. Oh, so this is a photograph. This is interesting. It's like, you know, trying to understand DNA and thinking about all those things. This is a photograph that was taken by my grandparents. They were in a museum. I don't know where the museum was, but out of that body of photographs I got, there was this image of some African art. Come find out, my family was from that same region in terms of DNA. Another thing happened was that same sculpture that's there, it's called a Demba, and that's from Guinea. That same sculpture, I remember bringing this African dealer over to my mom's house, and I brought him over, and I said, Mom, you can pick what you want. She said, okay. And so she picked the same sculpture. And this is not even knowing the DNA, which was kind of weird for me. So I just wanted to show that. This is called From east to west, from south to north. It's dealing with the migration of my family. By the way, a sea, but then also like my family members that were part of the Underground Railroad that ended up migrating to New Jersey. Met some Quakers, Safe House in South Jersey, and my family. That's stuff my father's side of family. And my father being a railroad engineer, and so that's one of the reasons why it's like the railroad tracks. All right, so this is like Echo, the piece that's here, was a part of this body of work. And Echo was just thinking about those thoughts about that, thinking about DNA, thinking about combination of things. It's made with Georgia clay, thinking about the red earth that's in West Africa, thinking about the echoes of thought, the connections between people crossing Atlantic. It's a return to things that were more sculptural, made in steel. So it's a combination of things. So, and the piece right there with the beehive, this piece was, you know, this has sound. And basically what I have is the sound of, you remember when the World Cup, and what do you call those, the sousaphones?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And that sound reminded me of bees. And I remember I was at his residency, and the guy was giving this tour about bees, and he was talking about bees, and he kept talking about this one time when the bees came, and there was a bad crop of bees, and there were these killer bees from Africa. I said, oh my God. And I started thinking, listening to him, and I was like, oh man, killer bees. And they were bad, and the honey was bitter. And so I at the same time, I went into my room, and the World Cup was on, and the sound of the phones. And I basically took the recording of that. And so when you walk up to it, you hear this strange sound, but it sounds just like the bees. And that's an actual bee's nest. And so, you know, it kind of gives you a little bit of a threatening feel. So that's that goal. All right, so this was, and sometimes, you know, I'm dealing with the studio, I think about current events, think about the uprisings, and looking at basically those busts. If you start from the bottom, there are these people, they're having these conversations, they start to talk, and they start to congregate a little bit more on the second level, and then all of a sudden they start to follow each other in terms of things they believe in, and then all of a sudden they start to look up above, because it's like when they make these choices, it has a lot to do with life and death. And this is a big medicine cabinet, so that's what it was on. And this was a photograph of one of Marcus Garvey's ships before he got it. It was all pristine. So I wanted to make it's basically a postcard, but it's made out of steel and glass. This is more like a self-portrait. I do self-portraits every once in a while, but it's a little bit different. And this is I like to play with the idea of this could be a river somewhere in West Africa. I know where it's from, or it could be the Mississippi. And it's photographs that are printed on top of steel. And the Negro world, I was just thinking about Garvey, my family members that were preachers. And, you know, I know when I went to the islands, it was always like this talk and go to these churches. And people talk about the churches and the rafters, what came from ships. And so basically I have a ship inside of a glass house. And then the Negro world was Marcus Garvey's paper, 54-6, dealt with like the address. And it's a blanket that is, I don't know. It's a combination of things. And I like it that sometimes I make things I don't really know what I'm doing. But I feel comfortable. So this was a thought, you know, thinking about Sun Ra and then thinking about Thelonious and spinning around planets. And it's loose. And I have this album that was given to me by someone, which was an album that Sun Ra would sell like in the middle of concerts, and he would draw on top of these albums with these magic markers. And so basically that's where some of the drawing and the mark making was about. And then this is Duke Ellington thinking about his music, so clean, so beautiful. And it's so clean, you're like, daggone, are there any imperfections? And then basically I looked at the wall and the Great Wall in Zimbabwe, and there's this wall at the top, and it's an image, and it's the wall has these bricks and it looks almost perfect. But when you go up on close up onto it, it's off, but it's perfect. So that's what that was about. So this is like the installation that's a part of the show. And all right, the story was about it was crossed between all the things that are happening, the storms, the things that happened in Japan, the things that happened in Katrina. It's also about like going fishing with my father and going out in the Delaware Bay. We almost went like 5 miles out to where we couldn't see land and feeling so small. It's about those lost at sea during the Middle Passage. It's about a combination of things, and I like to leave it where it's open to all those different interpretations. And so what you have is that conch shell that's at the corner. Conch shell was funny. It was like I was thinking about several different things. One of my favorite musicians was Rosson Roland Kirk, and he played these different instruments. He could play horns, like three horns at one time. And so I'm thinking about him, and he was playing a conch shell, and then I was thinking like, oh, that's interesting. All right, so then I work with this guy, I'm at a residency, and had him tape me while I'm installing this piece. As I'm installing this piece, I'm dropping the keys, and I'm actually listening to John Coltrane with earplugs and not paying any mind to what I'm, you know, the sound itself. So it's just natural in terms of the recording. So that made an actual good amplifier, the shell. So that's where that comes from. But you think about the piano keys and all the pianos and how much music's been played from each piano, and thinking about the one common thing that we all have in common is music and rhythms and sounds that we all relate to and love. And the earlier forms of DNA. And I think the one thing I think about is that once we get beyond all that, the reality is that we're all human. And so I deal with that. And I think about the sensibilities of a child and why it's so pure, because it's not tainted. And so that's what a lot of this is about. And so this is a heart, and it's based on the blues music, and blues musicians singing about love, but they always sing about it and they don't get it right. And so that's what this is about. And so in this room is just a reference to all those things of DNA and objects and sculpture. I made my own form of a Mende mask. Used a Mende mask that's in the collection of the High Museum, and then I did a reflection. So when you look at the mask, when you stand in there, you see the reflection of the other mask on the other side, and as you move to the left, it kind of does the same thing with a different image. And it's meant to open up like this, and that's part of like the play between a book. And it's 7 objects in that room. That's tricky. This is, that's a donkey. That's a donkey. Back to a whole subject of things I'm dealing with, civil wars and 40 acres and a mule, and then wrapping things up in rope and I have to figure out a way to play with the idea of 40. The number of 40, and figure out that amount and length of rope and things like that. So that's what I'm working on. This. Oh no. I think it's there.
You got it.
Stay here. This afternoon, Radcliffe created a work. So this is a very, when did you take this picture of Radcliffe?
I don't know, that's
like, yeah, it's brand new. And while he's been at Wellesley, this is one of the drawings he did.
Well, I don't like it.
I know, but I'm the curator. Sorry. He didn't want us to show these photos. They're so fresh. These are the things that he created while he was here at Wellesley. And Lisa said, no, we have to show this work. Right. And one of the works is, anyway, yeah. So you see, this was 3:00 this afternoon.
Oh, see, that's not right. That's not fair.
And
that's not fair. Do you always dress so stylishly in the studio?
No.
He asked today, so I need to get dressed for tonight, but I need to work in the studio. He's okay. So he did it. And there, that's in progress. In progress. The sketch is in preparation for making the print. Right. And the print, okay, now your turn.
This is Radcliffe. Put this image at the end.
Is this the last one?
Yeah. I think so. No, you have some.
No, this is it. Lisa, you wanna? Is it?
Yeah, oh. Good idea.
Thank you. You can tell we're all friends.
Yeah. So, we went. I went to Jack Shainman Gallery in New York, where Radcliffe's show was last spring. And it was just, absolutely smitten by this piece and really pleased that Wellesley was able to acquire it for the Davis. And, how exciting, right? Except that when you look at this, what you realize is that there are a lot of components that have to come together. So the installation is not just like putting a framed thing on the wall. Suddenly, we have to have more Georgia clay, and that's got to come in a tub. And how are we going to mix that up? And then how are we going to install that at the museum? And everybody started getting fairly wound up about this. So it turned out, as Andrew can attest, we had to create a kind of a plastic enclosed CSI space. It was very It was very dramatic. And then Radcliffe came and dressed in a big jumper suit and started to work with the clay to make the clay flow down the trough and down the fabric into this bowl to splatter on the wall. And it was really really great. It was really interesting. And, you know, of course, we had to document the whole thing. We ended up with this really great installation that creates all sorts of connections within the collection, generates all sorts of ideas about how photographs function and what it means, what place and space means, and what architectural forms mean, and how we imagine and live connections across places in history and geographically, culturally. So we are very delighted to have the piece in our collections. I think it's time for us to open up for some questions, if you'd like.
Simply, the Elmina series, how he chose the music on which he painted, and and my second question was just, was Elmina a place in Africa from which they came?
Right. It's right off the coast of Ghana. And Carol, I'd like for you to talk about
Elmina is currently a small fishing town, but it was the very first fort built by the Portuguese in 1482 when they first sailed around the coast of West Africa. Originally, it was for the gold trade, but that quickly flipped into the trade of enslaved Africans.
And they were beautiful as well as
thank you.
Hard, but they were also beautiful.
Thank you.
More than anything, I had a comment more so than a question. I just wanted to say that your work is incredible. I've never really had the chance to experience a lot of what you've done before, so this is a introductory to me. But your train of thought, like I was watching as you were explaining, you know, piece by piece, and I was just kind of blown away by it because there's so much invested in your work. So I just want to say thank you for investing that kind of time.
Oh, thank you.
If you were to sell your work, what price tag would you put on it?
Oh, I couldn't tell you. But my work is, I represent by a dealer in New York, named Jack Shaman. And a lot of the work that's in the show is already owned by individuals. But that's how I make my living. It's a tricky one. And for those my friends that are out here that are artists, we all know it's like crazy. I mean, but I think that part of the blessing about being an artist is that we can get up sometimes when we want to, but we got to pay for it later. Yeah. And we got to get work done.
I know. I write poetry myself, so
yeah.
I know.
You know? Yeah. But even on that, what you just said about, you know from the sense of poetry, I'm real interested in like drawing those connections between all the different practices, you know, because I think that, you know, I'm always informed by different people. I'm informed, like I have a piece that's upstairs, it's called Translucency. It was about, you know, a Mary Baraka. And so I think about all those different movements, different music. And I always think that if anything, that people that can change the world itself would be art.
Yeah, I have a question. Yes, hi. I was actually invited to be here. And again, as someone stated earlier, I'm like really truly blessed today to have witnessed such such gifting that you have. My question is more so like I sense a lot of emotion that you put forth into your work. It may be sensitive to you, but could you please and, you know, kindly speak a little bit on that?
About emotions.
Yeah, the emotions. I know.
Sad.
Please.
Happy.
Or maybe.
All right. My problem, my thoughts about that. Okay, whenever I have a problem, I go to the studio. I'm not a religious person, but the studio has become church. So studio has become a... Yes. So the studio has become more like church. And so I go and I have problems. I go to my paintings and I try to work out my problems. It's not obvious, but that's a part of it. I'm not afraid of dealing with those parts. Sometimes it's not easy, or it's not the coolest space to be in or understood.
I see that.
But for me, it took a minute where I had to carve out that space within my work and understand, like, it's okay. It's okay to be a little different. It's okay, and I think of it as, I was saying a little bit earlier, I was this kid that just, like, you know, thought of as being special and had, you know, things that were said, like, oh, he's a special kind of learner, he's different, da da da, put him in the back, put him, you know. But instead of doing the opposite, you give kids more.
Right.
And so my mother, being a school teacher, created a school outside of school. And that school outside of school was a combination of her taking me to one of the hippest places where people hung out. It was called Little Five Points in Atlanta. It's like everybody hung out. It was a cool place. It was vintage stores, and she showed me, like, go in there, you can buy some clothes there, because she knew I was a little different. And so I started doing that, and my mom, you know, I feel like I wouldn't be doing any of this if it wasn't for my mom, because she was the historian for me. I think I make art, and my mother is really an artist. Her favorite aunt, was an artist, and she used to go to the Barnes Foundation. She was friends with the wives. She was a painter in Philadelphia. And she introduced my mom to museums. And I remember as a kid, I was going to a museum, and I remember my mom said, we're gonna go see the show. And I was like, okay, go. And it was like Jacob Lawrence. And so she had me stand in line, and she said, this is my son. My son, he's gonna be an artist.
That's right.
And I remember that. And I was just shy, and I'm sitting there, he signed a little poster. He signed my poster of my book. I still have those things. They're sacred to me, but you know, that came from my mom. And sensitive Sagittarius. 25th. I was born on Thanksgiving. And I also see myself as a vessel. And things come through.
Thank you so much.
There's a question from a child, and there's another question over here. So after your question, and up over there, we'll pass it around.
Okay, again, just like everyone agreed, you have beautiful artwork, and I love the way you express yourself through your artwork. It's about reading in between the lines. A lot of the things that you're saying, especially about the level of secrecy that you display in your work. One of the things I wanted to ask you, as I am from RCC, so I'm part of a Images of Black American course, mm-hmm. And I wanted to ask you a question. As an African American man, what is your experience in the culture of art, and how does it define your manhood in this society?
I think I think that the arts are not necessarily celebrated, or you know, I'm there's a school that I'm familiar with in Atlanta, historical African American University, where there were a lot of great artists that came through at a certain moment. They connected, they bonded. Well-known ones, they have a large collection, but the sad part about it is when I look at this institution, they have this great art, but they, in terms of the art department, it's so small. Mm-hmm. It's so small, and, you know, the interest or the push towards the arts. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's the one thing that saved me. It's like going back and say, as a young African-American male, I mean, a lot of kids are very talented, and they see the world in a different way, but they don't necessarily get a chance to go to a museum or to see themselves exist so that they were not insecure about doing it. And I think that that is part of the problem. And I think that I was very fortunate, like I said, to have that mom, that person that guided me. And as I went on, I had other friends. I have another friend, you know, who gives me somewhat of the history. And he used to be director of Studio Museum in Harlem. And he gives me a whole different perspective. His name is Ed Spriggs. And he was like one of the first director of Studio. And he's a godparent to my kids. And, you know, it's like I live in within the art. I make art. But I also deal with the everyday life stuff. And so I deal with all those things. And that could be, you know, I feel like art is 20%, and then the other part is 80.
Really?
I mean, I don't work every day. I work once a week. I work at odd times. But when I do, I pack it all in. And I've also learned that in order to get stuff done, you have to be comfortable with every single line you make. And no line is a bad line. And I think imperfection is perfection.
Me too.
So, yeah. Sorry.
Hi.
Yay.
When you were finished with your work, did you have anything to do after?
When I'm finished with my work. Oh, yeah, yeah, I got it. It's perfect. All right. I struck a thought. When I'm finished, what do? I go to sleep. I go back in. I read. It reminds me of the question you just asked. I'll tell you one thing. It was a story. I mean, something that helped me when I was an art student. I never knew when to finish a painting. I took myself in the studio. I remember everybody went away for spring break. They went away for vacation. And I stayed in the studio, and I started working. And I hadn't really developed my work. But I worked, and I worked, and I started enjoying what I was doing. I didn't care anymore. A clock didn't matter. I just worked, and I worked. And I felt like I struck a note. In other words, it felt good. And I needed to keep going until it just, you know, it didn't feel good. And I worked for 2 days straight. And I finally felt like I made a piece or a body of work. And I still try to go to that same place when I'm working now where I can put that energy in. So to answer your question, I get rest and I get ready for a moment, that moment to happen again. So.
I have a question. I don't know him.
Yes, you do.
Thank you, dear.
Oh, here we go. You're going to give me a hard time.
No, I won't. I promise. I'm on my best behavior. Really, okay. I am. I think the three of you should have your own TV show, though. I think that would be really cute. The work with the donkeys
right.
that we saw towards the end, and the music stand. Mm-hmm. And the lanterns.
Mm-hmm.
So the work for me moves back and forth between things that are found
mm-hmm.
and things that are fabricated.
Right.
So how do you decide, like, instead of just using an actual music stand, how do you decide that you need to fabricate one? And with the donkeys, you know, there's a lot of artists doing things with taxidermy and things like that
right,
now.
Right.
So how do you decide that you need to fabricate something? How do you make those material kinds of choices?
Right. My favorite place to go is my favorite thing I like to, favorite thing I like to do is go antique shopping. And there's an antique fair that comes second weekend of every month. It's like, you know, what the library is for some people. And a part of it is going in and antiquing, is like going and smelling these old objects, and it's like going back in time. And so for me, that's a combination of that. So that stand was an antique that I actually collected, but I didn't know what to do with it. The donkey I've been watching for years as I'm going down this little small towns, and I see these little donkeys in the yard. And I kept thinking, like, what am I going to do with that donkey? And I think what it is that every subject and everything I'm trying to take through every part and every body and ways in which I work. So it's like, you know, instead of thinking, let me think about a subject matter. It's like you touch that subject matter. For me, it's like endless. It's like a donkey, the mule, the plow handle. I'm going to come back to it again. And so I keep going over and over. And I think I think at the end of the day, hopefully I'd created a body of work that was so different. Everything was so different, but connected. So right now, it's like I could take different parts of my work from different times and put it together and make something where it's like I have a show and not a seven different people. And I've always wanted to say, if I had seven different people in me, and I could work seven different ways, and I can have seven different types of income.
That's a real music
student? Again, I'm going to say that I loved your work. It's the first time I'm seeing you. I'm also from RCC with the Images of Black Americans class, so my question is, in this exhibition, I see Africa and things related to the slave trade. I wanted to know, one, if that's a reoccurring theme in any of your other works. And also, as a visual artist and a black male, has it been difficult to maybe shop work that is so heavily connected to the slave trade?
Okay, I'll answer that one too. The first one, the subject matter. I think it's just important. I think it's like, it's the history of all people. It's the history of human beings. And I think slavery is a short time period in the existence of a people. But I also feel like I have to do that for certain reasons. Some of the reasons have a lot to do with like me being able to talk to my kids or me being able to just talk to people. And I think about, you know what, sometimes I put in my mind when I'm making work, it's like, let's say if the average man didn't read and didn't know the King's English and just thought about the world in a different way. I'm more interested in communicating in that very basic way, but very complex. And I think about signs and symbols and things around the world. As I deal with the subject matter, I'm also dealing with my interest in different African practices and what they mean and how they relate to someone in Peru, how they relate to someone anywhere. And there's a certain way in which people are common and communicating what things do. You know, talking about up there, you know, and they're fascinated with all these things. As I deal with the subject matter, that's how I combat the pains, because I think about the beauties of it. And I'm fascinated with that kind of stuff. So.
Can I also interject that, you know, the question came up when the show opened in Atlanta, and I was thinking about what it was like to show that work in Atlanta and what it was like to show the work here at Wellesley, and thinking about little kids who come to the museum and how you talk about slavery with little kids, that's heavy. And what I realized in Atlanta is that all these little kids were finding their way into the work in totally magically, because they were seeing things, hidden things, letters and numbers. They were finding objects hidden in the work that meant that they were reading this work on an entirely different level. And it struck me that that was what was magical, was the ability, the work's expansiveness, the work's openness, that's singular. That's about Radcliffe.
I just want to say that RCC means Roxbury Community College.
Thank you.
I'm the instructor. I'm also an alum of Wellesley College, class of 95.
Oh, yeah.
I'm very happy to bring my class here, and I just wanted to ask you, are you at all interested in incorporating or responding to hip-hop?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I do.
Okay.
I do. I do in terms of, I'll tell you how I do. I used to have a relationship with hip-hop groups, and then also, like, with my cousin worked in the music industry. And I think that one of my earliest parts when I was in school, I was always trying to figure out how to connect all these things, connect the dots. And I think that, you know, you look at, like, someone, and they're gone, and their parents' music, and they pull out this old James Brown album, and they pull out this old album, and they put these things together. In terms of that part and improvisation of that part, that's heavy to me in my work. It's about making those, it's not as obvious and literal, but it's very much there. Because when I think about the music itself, I think about its connections between jazz, I think about its connections between the blues. I see some parts of it that may be even negative. And I even think that that's connected to the blues, because they have to work out their issues in some form. And guess what? The rhythm itself is beautiful. The pain is real. The confusion can be real. And that's kind of like, even in my own work, I throw it out there, but I don't, it looks different. And the first, one of my first relationships was hip-hop music was out. There was this group called Arrested Development. Right, so in the music video, you see this guy drawing a picture of a lynching? That was me. So that's kind of like some of that. I hate to talk about it. Because I don't, you know, when it happened, I was like, no, don't let my friends see this video. They're going to laugh at me.
While the show was on view at the High, Radcliffe recommended his favorite DJs, and we had a whole evening in the museum's atrium with 2,000 people dancing till midnight. We tried to get the security to let us stay longer, but then we carried on elsewhere. You should see Radcliffe on the dance floor. He's like a sailboat.
There was another question over here, and I've lost track of the mic.
So I know the students have really enjoyed your exhibit so far, and it seems like it's definitely an Atlantic narrative. Do you also consider it to be an American narrative?
You said Atlantic?
Atlantic, like crossing between.
Yeah.
So do you also consider it to be an American narrative, like an American story?
I think of it, yes. Yes and no. It's like trying to use something that recognizable and it's old and presence is subject matter. Hey, he's African American. But it's also about, I keep coming back to this whole thing about human, making it where it connects to, like take for instance, you see the old photographs and a lot of times people have the assumption that they're all from the South. No, they're my Northern family members. But then at the same time, they migrated from the South to the North. But then I have family members who didn't migrate from the South to the North, but actually came to the North by a different way. There's a connection, a question about Africa, but I'm interested in, even beyond Africa, I'm interested in where people talk about going into these other worlds that, you know, you hear about. They talk about it, you know, with those in Egypt. They talk about Machu Picchu. They talk about the Dogon talk about it a particular way. But people in general, they talk about this other place. Mm-hmm. And I think that that other place sometimes is just a different state of mind that transforms. Sometimes I believe I live in my dreams, catch hell, and I flip it, and I'm trying to take that surreal dream and make it real within my work. And so I think sometimes we think about death and things that happen, and we see these things, and I think in some strange world that I'll live forever.
Wow. High five on that one.
But I think about it, and part of it is that, family and people that come before you, and people still live, you know. I think about all that. We're all connected. I think that we're still existing.
Yes.
I think that some of the things that we, like I always think like this too. It's like one of the issues, and I hate my dad, we laugh about it all the time, but I think that one of the problems, the issues in the world is that there's so many men in control. I hate, but you know, I'm one, but you know, I think that... I think it's more so the male ego, and then one thing I learned about the Mende women, and they control the society, and I start thinking like my mom, and I start thinking like, oh, that's what's right, okay. But I also think that conflict and things like that can be solved. Women know how to solve those conflicts, but when the problem comes is when the men come in and want to take control. So I, okay.
Three more conversations or questions in the room. So, should we start over here? We'll get over there, and there's the stuff as well. But I think. You've probably been
Hello, my name's Dana, and I just wanted to ask during the beginning of the presentation, you said art for you was hiding from your inadequacies. Insecurity, my fault.
Okay.
Sorry, that's my fault.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to know, with you said memories as medicine was very personal for you.
Right.
So I wanted to know what inadequacy. Insecurities. I don't know why I keep saying that. Insecurities. You addressed through either personal memory or collective memory.
Both. Both. You know, there's a lot of, every day, it's like, I think about things, and I think we all think about things in a different way. I think sometimes we don't necessarily question all those things, and I think for myself, I think about all those things. And I don't know. Think about it in terms of all of us and myself. It's a good question.
Question over here.
Hi. In your PowerPoint presentation, I think it was slide one, it was the family, your family tree. I have a question in regards to the members. Are they your members or just a family tree of people?
The photographs were from my family album. And my grandmother gave me those photographs. And so I started, you know, working with those photographs. But the ideal family, because I didn't know exactly who they were, they could have been friends of family. And that's pretty much, a lot of them were friends of family. But then also I knew that my grandmother was connected to this orphanage up in Philadelphia. And so I was thinking about those connections too, because I have a lot of images of children, a lot. I think it's, in the bigger sense of family, yes.
Maybe after the show, can I see? Because it kind of looks like my dad when he was little.
See, that kind of thing, actually what happened to me sometimes at openings, is that people come up to me and make mention of the, you know, this looks like blah, 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 blah. And I get a lot. Actually, I get more information from an opening and sharing than I go just on a regular search. Mm-hmm. But I grow from it.
I hope this is my last question. I think you're our last question for the evening.
Okay. Yes, hi again. I'm so sorry. Again, I'm just really sorry, but I have to reiterate the fact that, you know, I'm truly blessed, you know, to be in your presence and to, you know, having viewed all your artwork. My question is more specifically, if at all, have you had any spiritual, like, experiences or encounters? I know I'm asking you the difficult question. I apologize. Only because you said you made reference to doing a lot of your, crafting a lot of your artwork, you know, at odd hours, like 3 a.m. For me personally, I've worked like 14, 15 years overnight shift. And, you know, personally, I've experienced and encountered a lot. I work at a women and children's center, so that's mainly the reason why I asked, because as you had your painting with a lot of, I think it depicted a lot of children. I can't remember quite which slide it was, but it kind of resounded and it spoke to me. Recently, I think I literally had a vision of that exact painting. So that's why I'm asking, like, you know, spiritually, I know a lot of people don't want to talk about the other realms and what have you, but I'd like, you know, to know more if you have anything to say about that. Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, man.
Please, if you may, Mr. Radcliffe.
You mean, is there somebody in my studio hiding my brushes and stuff like that?
No. Whatever it is that you would like to respond, I'm willing to listen.
I think whenever you deal with things that have a past, you deal with the person who had the past. I think when you go through and look and you work with older objects and photographs, you can't help but feel the presence of a person. And I think what it is part of that is, like, even, you know, those of us that are artists, as we make our work, hopefully we're making it so, I mean, in a way, we're dealing with that. We're making work and it has a life after us. When we're gone, it's still here. And that's part of the part where I think that you never really disappear, but you reappear. And I think about the moments in terms of, like, you know, slave trade and those lost at sea and these people, this certain time period. I think about all those things. And I think they live and exist within all of us. And I think about all that. And so I sometimes feel as if they're still here. And a tree, you know, I walk through, I have Civil War grounds in my backyard. I live, like, right the Battle of Utoy Creek, and it's like about 8 acres, and my property butts into a nature preserve. So every day I get up and I walk my dog. I climb the fence, cut through the woods, climb the fence, and I walk this trail. The trail probably takes me about 45 minutes to go, but there's a lot of markings on the trail. There's a tree that's hollowed out where 2 or 3 people could fit within it. I think about those. I think about kind of like the past history. So I like to sometimes dwell within those spaces. And I try to find a sense of peace with all that. It's like going to New Orleans. You go to New Orleans and you go through St. Louis number 1 or 2, and you feel the presence of these people and they're buried up above ground, and you feel the histories of the water rising and all those things. You feel the smell, and you hear something, you question. I just learn to be comfortable with it. The wind blows, the wind blows. But the wind also tells you that the weather's changing.
That's right.
And so I think about it in that kind of way. when you talk about, you know, I think about spirit, spirituality, all those things. Yeah, in fact, I'm also interested in all the different practices by way of West Africa, too. And so I have, you know, looked into those. But as an artist, it's hard for me to go into a direct direction, like to go this way or go that way. Part of it was like I had to know my DNA. And as I knew my DNA, I started to realize that I have a makeup of all different types of people in me, beyond the fact of African, Native American, and Europeans. And then I also have other parts. So I deal with all that and realize that all those different things kind of influence my work in different ways. So in many ways, I feel as I'm as American as American can be. And I'm as much of a person of the world as one can be, too. And so I start thinking about all that. All right.
Wait a minute. We have to go over to the museum lobby. We have a reception prepared. I hope you all join us. And you can feel free to have a conversation with Radcliffe in the lobby. Thank you all for being here.
No, this is it. This is it. Lisa, you wanna? Is it?
Oh.
Thank you. You can tell we're all friends.
Yeah. So, you know, I went to Jack Shainman Gallery in New York, where Radcliffe's show was last spring, and was just, you know, absolutely smitten by this piece, and really pleased that Wellesley was able to acquire it for the Davis. And, you know, how exciting, right? Except that when you look at this, what you realize is that there are a lot of components that have to come together. So the installation is not just like putting a framed thing on the wall. Suddenly, we have to have more Georgia clay, and that's got to come in a tub. And how are we going to mix that up? And then how are we going to install that at the museum? And everybody started getting fairly wound up about this. So it turned out, as Andrew can attest, we had to create a kind of a plastic enclosed CSI space. It was very dramatic. And then Radcliffe came and dressed in a big jumper suit and started to work with the clay to make the clay flow down the trough and down the fabric into this bowl to splatter on the wall. And it was really, it was just really great. It was really interesting. And, you know, of course, we had to document the whole thing. We ended up with this really great installation that creates all sorts of connections within the collection, generates all sorts of ideas about how photographs function and what it means, what place and space means, and what architectural forms mean, and how we imagine and live connections across places in history and geographically, culturally. So we are very delighted to have the piece in our collections. I think it's time for us to open up for some questions, if you'd like.
Simply, the Elmina series, how he chose the music on which he painted, and and my second question was just, was Elmina a place in Africa from which they came?
Right. It's right off the coast of Ghana. And Carol, I'd like for you to talk about
Elmina is currently a small fishing town, but it was the very first fort built by the Portuguese in 1482 when they first sailed around the coast of West Africa. Originally, it was for the gold trade, but that quickly flipped into the trade of enslaved Africans.
And they were beautiful, as well as
thank you.
Hard, but they were also beautiful.
Thank you.
More than anything, I had a comment more so than a question. I just wanted to say that your work is incredible. I've never really had the chance to experience a lot of what you've done before, so this is an introductory to me. But your train of thought, like, I was watching as you were explaining, you know, piece by piece, and I was just kind of blown away by it because there's so much invested in your work. So I just want to say thank you for investing that kind of time.
Oh, thank you.
If you were to sell your work, what price tag would you put on it?
Oh, I couldn't tell you. But my work is, I represent by a dealer in New York, named Jack Shaman. And a lot of the work that's in the show is already owned by individuals. But that's how I make my living. It's a tricky one. And for those of my friends that are out here that are artists, we all know it's like crazy. I mean, but I think that part of the blessing about being an artist is that we can get up sometimes when we want to, but we got to pay for it later. Yeah. We got to get work done.
I know. I write poetry myself, so yeah. I know.
You know? Yeah. But even on that, what you just said about, you know from the sense of poetry, I'm real interested in like drawing those connections between all the different practices, you know, because I think that, you know, I'm always informed by different people. I'm informed, like I have a piece that's upstairs, it's called Translucency. It was about, you know, Amiri Baraka. So I think about all those different movements, different music. And I always think that if anything, that people that can change the world itself would be art.
Yeah, another question. Yes, hi. I was actually invited to be here. And again, as someone stated earlier, I'm like really truly blessed today to have witnessed such gifting that you have. My question is more so like, I sense a lot of emotion that you put forth into your work. It may be sensitive to you, but could you please and, you know, kindly speak a little bit on that?
About emotion.
Yeah, the emotion. I know.
Sad.
Please.
Happy.
Or maybe.
All right. My problem, my thoughts about that. Okay, whenever I have a problem, I go to the studio. I'm not a religious person, but the studio has become church. So studio has become a... Yes. So the studio has become more like church. And so I go and I have problems. I go to my paintings and I try to work out my problems. It's not obvious, but that's a part of it. I'm not afraid of dealing with those parts. Sometimes it's not easy, or it's not the coolest space to be in or understood.
I see that.
But for me, it took a minute where I had to carve out that space within my work and understand, like, it's okay. It's okay to be a little different. It's okay, and I think of it as, I was saying a little bit earlier, I was this kid that just like, you know, thought of as being special and had, you know, things that were said, like, oh, he's a special kind of learner, he's different, da da da, put him in the back, put him, you know, he, you know. But instead of doing the opposite, you give kids more. And so my mother, being a school teacher, created a school outside of school. And that school outside of school was a combination of her taking me to one of the hippest places where people hung out. It was called Little Five Points in Atlanta. It's like everybody hung out. It was a cool place. It was vintage stores, and she showed me, like, go in there, you can buy some clothes there, because she knew I was a little different. And so I started doing that, and my mom, you know, I feel like I wouldn't be doing any of this if it wasn't for my mom, because she was the historian for me. I think I make art, and my mother is really an artist. Her favorite aunt was an artist, and She used to go to the Barnes Foundation. She was friends with the wives. She was a painter in Philadelphia. And she introduced my mom to museums. And I remember as a kid, I was going to a museum, and I remember my mom said, we're gonna go see the show. And I was like, okay, go. And it was like Jacob Lawrence. And so she had me stand in line, and she said, this is my son. My son, he's gonna be an artist.
That's right.
And I remember that, and I was just shy, and I'm sitting there, and signed my little poster, signed my poster of my book. I still have those things. They're sacred to me, but, you know, that came from my mom. And sensitive Sagittarius, 25th, I was born on Thanksgiving. And I also see myself as a vessel, and things come through.
There's a question from a child, and there's another question over here. So after your question, and up over there, we'll pass it around.
Okay, again, just like everyone agreed, you have beautiful artwork, and I love the way you express yourself through your artwork. It's about reading in between the lines. A lot of the things that you're saying, especially about the level of secrecy that you display in your work. One of the things I wanted to ask you, as I am from RCC, so I'm part of a Images of Black American course, mm-hmm. And I wanted to ask you a question. As an African American man, what is your experience in the culture of art, and how does it define your manhood in this society?
I think I think that the arts are not necessarily celebrated, or there's a school that I'm familiar with in Atlanta, historical African American University, where there were a lot of great artists that came through at a certain moment. They connected, they bonded. Well-known ones, they have a large collection. But the sad part about it is when I look at this institution, they have this great art, but they, in terms of the art department, it's so small. Mm-hmm. It's so small. And, you know, the interest or the push towards the arts. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's the one thing that saved me. It's like going back and say, as a young African-American male, I mean, a lot of kids are very talented and they see the world in a different way, but they don't necessarily get a chance to go to a museum or to see themselves exist so that they were not insecure about doing it. And I think that that is part of the problem. And I think that I was very fortunate, like I said, to have that mom, that person that guided me. And as I went on, I had other friends. I have another friend, who gives me somewhat of the history. And he used to be director of Studio Museum in Harlem. And he gives me a whole different perspective. His name is Ed Spriggs. And he was like one of the first directors of Studio. And he's a godparent to my kids. And, you know, it's like I live in within the art. I make art. But I also deal with the everyday life stuff. And so I deal with all those things. And that could be, you know, I feel like art is 20%, and then the other part is 80%.
Really?
I mean, I don't work every day. I work once a week. I work at odd times, but when I do, I pack it all in. And I've also learned that in order to get stuff done, you have to be comfortable with every single line you make. And no line is a bad line. And I think imperfection is perfection.
Me too.
So, yeah. Sorry.
Hi.
Yay.
When you were finished with your work, did you have anything to do after?
when I finish with my work. Oh, yeah, yeah, I got it. It's perfect. All right. I struck a thought. When I finish, what do I do? I go to sleep. I go back in. I read. It reminds me, the question you just asked, I'll tell you one thing. It was a story, I mean, something that helped me when I was an art student. I never knew when to finish a painting. I took myself in the studio. I remember everybody went away for spring break. They went away for vacation. And I stayed in the studio, and I started working. And I hadn't really developed my work. But I worked, and I worked, and I started enjoying what I was doing. I didn't care anymore. A clock didn't matter. I just worked, and I worked. And I felt like I struck a note. In other words, it felt good. And I needed to keep going until it just, you know, I'm still working on this, and I'm sharing some of these ideas and thoughts as I'm working. So this lantern itself, it's probably about maybe yay tall. And what I'm gonna do is put insects on the inside of it, and insects from all around the world, and ideas this person has traveled around the world. So that's what I'm working on now. This is another one where I pretty much printed a photograph on top of a mirror, a translucent mirror. And I still playing with the idea of that tintype and trying to make that. And that one's probably about maybe five feet, yeah. And so, and that's where some of this image that's upstairs came from. It started from those ideals and those thoughts. And this one's based on ghosts. And all it is to me, it was like I took a picture with my iPhone of a negative of one of my photographs and put it against the back of my yard, which I live on old Civil War grounds. I put it got back against the back of my yard and photographed with my iPhone. And then I printed it on top of a mirror. This is called Storm at Sea. And so this, you know, Shango, and then thinking about Shango, da-da-da-da, if he was able to cast a storm during the slave trade and the piano keys, and it refers to the music, da-da-da. So it's a combination of all these different thoughts. And, you know, one kind of music, I listen to classical music, I don't know, like maybe 3 or 4 in the morning when I'm working. It's kind of like a soundtrack that I have built going on. And this is called Notes from Elmina. And the Notes from Elmina, I don't know. I was thinking about painful subject matters, but I'm always trying to figure out a way to tell the story and then throw beauty at the same time with a painful subject matter. And it's very difficult. And I think that earlier in my work, I was dealing with painful subject matters, but I did not know how to deal with it in a space where to deal with it and get through it and deal with the beauty and the existence of people. So. And these are ones that, I won't talk about this one, it's Western Currents, but just thinking about all different parts of West Africa, African Americans came from, and then, you know, that search, and so I started using the African art. Oh, so this is a photograph, this is interesting, it's like, you know, trying to understand DNA and thinking about all those things. This is a photograph that was taken by my grandparents. They were in a museum, I don't know where the museum was, but out of that body of photographs I got, there was this image of some African art. Come find out, my family was from that same region in terms of DNA. Another thing happened was that same sculpture that's there is it's called a Demba, and that's from Guinea. That same sculpture, I remember bringing this African dealer over to my mom's house, and I brought him over, and I said, Mom, you can pick what you want. She said, okay. And so she picked the same sculpture. And this is not even knowing the DNA, which was kind of weird for me. So that's, I just wanted to show that. This is called from East to West, from South to North. It's dealing with the migration of my family. By the way, a sea, but then also like my family members that were part of the Underground Railroad that
ended up migrating to New Jersey. Met some Quakers, Safe House in South Jersey, and my family. That's stuff my father's side of the family. And my father being a railroad engineer, and so that's one of the reasons why it's like the railroad tracks. All right, so this is like Echo, the piece that's here, was a part of this body of work. And Echo was just thinking about those thoughts about that, thinking about DNA, thinking about combination of things. It's made with Georgia clay, thinking about the red earth that's in West Africa, thinking about the echoes of thought, the connections between people crossing the Atlantic. It's a return to things that were more sculptural, made in steel. So it's a combination thing. So, and the piece right there with the beehive, this piece was, you know, this has sound. And basically what I have is the sound of, you remember when the World Cup, and what do you call those, the sousaphones?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And that sound reminded me of bees. And I remember I was at his residency, and the guy was giving this tour about bees, and he was talking about bees, and he kept talking about this one time when the bees came, and there was a bad crop of bees, and there were these killer bees from Africa. I said, oh my God. And I started thinking, listening to him, and I was like, oh man, killer bees, and they were bad, and the honey was bitter. And so I at the same time, I went into my room, and the World Cup was on, and the sound of the phones, and I basically took the recording of that, and so when you walk up to it, you hear this strange sound, but it sounds just like the bees, and that's an actual bee's nest, and so, you know, it kind of gives you a little bit of a threatening feel, so that's that cool. All right, so this was you, and sometimes, you know, I'm dealing with the studio, I think about current events, think about the uprisings. And looking at basically those busts, if you start from the bottom, there are these people, they're having these conversations, they start to talk and they start to congregate a little bit more on the second level, and then all of a sudden they start to follow each other in terms of things they believe in, and then all of a sudden they start to look up above, because it's like when they make these choices, it has a lot to do with life and death. And this is a big medicine cabinet, so that's what it was on. And this was a photograph of one of Marcus Garvey's ships before he got it. It was all pristine. So I wanted to make a it's basically a postcard, but it's made out of steel and glass. This is more like a self-portrait. I do self-portraits every once in a while, but it's a little bit different. And this is either... I like to play with the idea this could be a river somewhere in West Africa. I know where it's from, or it could be the Mississippi. And it's photographs that are printed on top of steel. The Negro world, I was just thinking about Garvey, my family members that were preachers. And, you know, I know when I went to the islands, it was always like this talk and go to these churches, and people talk about the churches and the rafters, what came from ships. And so basically I have a ship inside of a glass house. And then the Negro World was Marcus Garvey's paper, 54-6, dealt with like the address. And it's a blanket that is, I don't know, it's a combination of things. And I like it that sometimes I make things I don't really know what I'm doing. But I feel comfortable. So this was a thought, you know, thinking about Sun Ra and then thinking about Thelonious and spinning around planets. And it's kind of, yeah, it's loose. And I have this album that was given to me by someone, which was an album that Sun Ra would sell like in the middle of concerts, and he would draw on top of these albums with these magic markers. And so basically that's where some of the drawing and the mark making was about. And then this is Duke Ellington thinking about his music, so clean, so beautiful. And it's so clean, you're like, daggone, are there any imperfections? And then basically I looked at the wall, and the Great Wall in Zimbabwe, and there's this wall at the top, It's an image, and it's the wall has these bricks, and it looks almost perfect. But when you go up on close up onto it, it's off, and but it's perfect. So that's what that was about. So this is like the installation that's a part of the show. The story was about, it was crossed between all the things that are happening, the storms, the things that happened in Japan, the things that happened in Katrina. It's also about like going fishing with my father and going out in the Delaware Bay. We almost went like 5 miles out to where we couldn't see land and feeling so small. It's about those lost at sea during the Middle Passage. It's about a combination of things, and I like to leave it where it's open to all those different interpretations. And so what you have is that conch shell that's at the corner. Conch shell was funny. It was like I was thinking about several different things. One of my favorite musicians was Rosson Roland Kirk, and he played these different instruments. He could play horns, like three horns at one time. And so I'm thinking about him, and he was playing a conch shell, and then I was thinking like, oh, that's interesting. All right, so then I work with this guy, I'm at a residency, and I had him tape me while I'm installing this piece. As I'm installing this piece, I'm dropping the keys, and I'm actually listening to John Coltrane with earplugs and not paying any mind to what I'm, the sound itself. So it's just natural in terms of the recording. So that made an actual good amplifier, the shell. So that's where that comes from. But you think about the piano keys and all the pianos and how much music's been played from each piano, and thinking about the one common thing that we all have in common is music and rhythms and sounds that we all relate to and love. And the earlier forms of DNA. And I think the one thing I think about is that once we get beyond all that, the reality is that we're all human. And so I deal with that. And I think about the sensibilities of a child and why it's so pure, because it's not tainted. And so that's what a lot of this is about. And so this is a heart, and it's based on the blues music and blues musicians singing about love. But they always sing about it and they don't get it right. And so that's what this is about. And so in this room is just a reference to all those things of DNA and objects and sculpture. I made my own form of a Mende mask. Used a Mende mask that's in the collection of the High Museum, and then I did a reflection. So when you look at the mask, when you stand in there, you see the reflection of the other mask on the other side, and as you move to the left, it kind of does the same thing with a different image. And it's meant to open up like this, and that's part of like the play between a book. And it's 7 objects in that room. That's tricky. This is, that's a donkey. That's a donkey. It's back to the whole subject of things I'm dealing with, civil wars and 40 acres and a mule, and then wrapping things up in rope and I have to figure out a way to play with the idea of 40. The number of 40 and figure out that amount and length of rope and things like that. So that's what I'm working on. This. Oh no. I think it's there.
You got it.
Stay here. This afternoon, Radcliffe created a work. So this is a very, when did you take this picture, Radcliffe?
I don't know, last week.
Yeah, it's brand new. And while he's been at Wellesley, this is one of the drawings he did.
Well, I don't like it.
I know, but I'm the curator. Sorry. He didn't want us to show these photos. They're so fresh. These are the things that he created while he was here at Wellesley. And Lisa said, no, we have to show this work. Right. And one of the works is, anyway, yeah. So you see, this was 3 o'clock this afternoon.
See, that's not right. That's not fair.
And
that's not fair.
Do you always dress so stylishly in the studio?
No.
He asked today, so I need to get dressed for tonight, but I need to work in the studio. He's okay. So he did it. And there, that's in progress. In progress. The sketch is in preparation for making the print. Yeah. Right. Yeah. And the print, okay, now your turn.
This is, Radcliffe. Put this image at the end.
Is this the last? I don't mind. I like the flesh, that pink. I worked with that, it was very difficult. But I did like 9 of these paintings just for every month. And this is a piece that was done on, it's called Four Corners, and it's based on Thelonious Monk. But then it's also based on Thelonious Monk, you know, how he'd get up and he'd spin around in a circle, and referring to him almost like Whirling Dervish, but then almost imitating the planets, his middle name, Sphere, and then also dealing with quilts and quilt making in the, and then also constellations. The constellations, the white dots are made out of thimbles. And a metronome, like an old grandfather's clock. This is called Denmark Meets Shango. Right. And so this one is made out of, I don't talk a lot about this one, but I used tobacco, I used rum, and Georgia clay. And then also the axe. The axe is in there, used to cut tobacco, but when I put it on, it's like a mirror surface. So the mirror surface almost reflected almost as deity named Shango. Shango being like a, amongst the Yoruba, you know, some attributes, or I guess like lightning and things like that. And colors were red and white. And so the Georgia clay worked perfect with that, dealing with sacrifices and blood and Native Americans. I'm bouncing around, but I work on, I think for me, it's become best for me to work on sculpture, painting, and do it all at once. It all relates and it changes, but it's like every painting is like a page, and I'm making this book, and that's how I look at it. This is based on Fela. Yeah, this is a show that I was in, because Fela is one of my favorite musicians. And I also loved, I loved his music, but I loved the way he spoke. I mean, as an artist, and I think that he just put the purpose of an artist back in order for me at moments when I'm working and working for a reason. And, you know, reason beyond myself sometimes. This is Black Star Line. I had family members that were Garveyites, and so it's a reference to those family members. Those are photographs of the moon. I go out on a full moon and take pictures of a moon, or go to the ocean, tape, record the ocean. It's a combination of a lot of things. I won't go into it. I got to get through these photos, these images. This is called Southern Crescent, based on the train. It was called the Southern Crescent. Sometimes I think, what's her name, sung the song about the midnight train to Georgia. I think about that a lot when I do this. But Southern Crescent was a train that went from south to north. And my father being a railroad engineer, and it's a combination of my father being a railroad engineer, and we used to catch the Southern Crescent at night, and catch at 7 o'clock at night. We roll into Charlottesville, Virginia around 8 or 9 in the morning, and it refers to that. One of the photographs was a photograph that was one from that family album, but it was all these men on a train, and I couldn't really figure out what the photograph was about. And all these men on a train, and people were saying goodbye to them, and so it was this, either they were going north for work or war. And the question about, you know, African Americans and fighting in wars and battles. And so it's a combination of that, and that's a full moon, but what I do, something also, I go and I take a picture of full moon, but I would imitate my daughter's drawings at the time with the moon, because the shutter stay on been long. This is a installation. It's called Spiritual Migration. It's that green again that my grandfather bought on the wall. I had different bodies of water, but different places in space. I had the Delta, Niger, you know, all these different bodies of water, Mississippi. And I jokingly said that I put water in from the Mississippi inside the bottles. And I remember I had this show. It was in Texas. It was a traveling show. The night of the opening, it rained. You know what? It rained for about 2 weeks. I think it was this time in the floods in Texas. And during my opening, the water came into the gallery and touched the bottles. And the show closed. And they invited me to come back again, but they put me upstairs. So this is another about the railroad and travel. My father, but you know, imitate my daughter's drawings, but I was thinking of migration of music. I had sounds of, in that first room you had sounds of the ocean. You came around this room, you had sounds of trains. You came around this room, you had the smell of tobacco, but then also the sounds of insects on a full moon. Those are like images, and I kind of, I don't know. It did a bunch of things for me. This is more like a self-portrait. And it's more so of like a trickster. Trickster, red and black, number three, cigars, rum, twisted roots, machetes. Sometimes somebody can share information, and then sometimes somebody you don't want to cross paths with. So, you know, I think we all have certain sides of ourselves. So this was like the whole installation. I'll go through it. You had the smells of tobacco. These are like medicine cabinets to me. I started making these paintings called, they're based on medicine cabinets. The idea is that whenever you're sick, you go to a medicine cabinet and get something to make you feel good. Well, for me, it was like memory. And so I go into these photographs, and these objects, and these things from the past. So these are not made to be as like paintings as much as they are meant to be open in their cabinets. This is one, it's just based on, I tell you stories rather than being specific about the painting itself. But GWC dealt with George Washington Carver. George Washington Carver, I remember as a kid, my mother taking us on these kind of field trips throughout the South. And I remember going to Tuskegee, and at the time when we went through Tuskegee, that George Washington Carver's lab was set up. And I remember looking through and seeing that. But then also thinking about all the experimentation and experiments he's doing with the peanut, he painted, and thinking about all those things. And when I'm in the studio working, I feel like I'm doing a lot of experimenting too. And sometimes it's experimenting, you see stuff, there's stuff that you play with and you work with, and there's things you don't talk about. And part of that is having a certain level of secrecy within your work and to protect. But so much you can reveal at a certain point. And I deal with the everyday issues in life and things that you question. And I cover it up sometimes with these objects that can relate to people. And I also believe that making things that become so personal that they become universal. And so some of these are like counting the numbers, and it's painted with indigo. It's like a medicine cabinet. It's about 8 inches deep, I think. This is a piano, and it's called Minor, and it's made to be like a fish tank, and you look inside the fish tank. But then I always wanted to go two different places, the deepest ends of the ocean. I wanted to be that guy going down 7 miles, but I wanted to go out of space, and because they're so similar, and I feel like we sit at a crossroads between those two worlds. This is another studio shot. This is called Bluebird from Seventh Sphere, and Bluebird was dealing with Charlie Parker. Bluebird. But in Atlanta, there's this truck stop. It has this huge, big Bluebird. It's probably about the size of the whole screen. And I remember seeing it as I drive by on the expressway. And so what I did was make a replica of it, and so the lights go around. And it's a saxophone in the stomach. I was doing stuff as part of a show that was based on the Black Panthers, and I was doing stuff about the breakfast program that the Panthers had, and then I also was using different objects and symbols. This is called bird on bird. And so what's happening is that Charlie Parker's music's playing. There's an African finch inside the cage. On top, up under the African finch, there's sheep music. And so the bird jumps up and chirps to the music and also makes work. And so there's a body of work that it really looks like Pollock. But but there's a body, and that's the bird. And it, yeah. This one's based on architecture of plantations. I was looking at the African influence on the architecture on plantations. And it's a combination of things. I don't really talk a lot about it. This is called Indigo Pugilus. I was making these things on military blankets. This is called Liberators. Since baseball was my first passion in dealing with that subject, I kind of go back and forth to these subjects a lot. Yeah. The bat's called cleanup. Just like the bat that's here, I needed a bat to beat down all my problems, and so that's what that's for. And this was my baseball jersey, but it's made to look like a hunter's jacket. And a lot of references towards African art, too. This is like Georgia Clay and thinking about, I don't know. I don't know. I'm trying to figure out a title for this one. I still haven't. All right, so then there's like this trip I made. So I did my DNA and I traced my on my mother's side to Sierra Leone and Guinea. And so I started to think about recovering. So a lot of this is like you see different images of African art going within the boats and dealing with recovering, trying to understand. And nowadays we got DNA. We could trace back to the scene of the crime. And so when I learned about this, this was like the first piece I did, which I basically did a little painting inside a little tintype of a Mende mask. So this is a boat that I made, and it was called Black Redemption. And it was a part of his bait. And it's thinking about Marcus Garvey and these boats he had, and they didn't make it, but I think that concept, the ideals, and the thoughts about that live on today, and they make a lot of sense. So that was like, to me, like a boat that's supposed to make it. And this is another boat. And so this is, at the same time, when I was making that boat, my cousin was working on this. And Virginia, where my grandparents were from, he lives there now, and he was making this car. And I was like, hey, I just went to West Africa. I just went, to Senegal, da-da-da, and this is what I'm making. I'm making this boat. And he's like, yeah, I'm making mine. What color should I paint it? We said, we'll paint it black. So that's what that was. So inside the car, there was a video screen playing of a video that me and a group of friends did when we went to Senegal. And I went with a choreographer, and a choreographer named Fatima Robinson. She does a lot of hip hop videos, but then also a musician named Mark Anthony Thomas. Yep. And so we worked together and we went and we had similar DNA. And this is a speedboat. The idea of a speedboat, you can get there pretty fast, so that's why it's twirling. And so there's a DNA strand that's twirling, breaking up in the back. So I made these are based on the Door No Return. It's a photograph of the ocean, but then it's like a glittery black screen. And the photograph is actually from Cuba. I took the photograph when I went to Cuba and used that. I don't tell anybody that, but it's supposed to just be ocean. It was just pretty. And so what I did was replicate the Door No Return inside the gallery. And there's a video projector that shoots a friend of mine dancing, and she's twirling in a circle, and then all of a sudden she turns into smoke. And so the video is shot on top of the screen, and as it moves, it kind of sparkles. So I was making these things that were more like contemporary versions of a tintype. And I wanted to make like these things, and so I print photographs on top of steel. And so that's probably about maybe 3 feet by 2 feet. But yeah, and so I made them. I was thinking about more like family trees. These are things I'm still working on. So all these different ways I'm working, I'm constantly bouncing back into it. I haven't abandoned any of it. I just kind of pick moments to go back into it. And the use of photographs and trying to figure out new ways to do things for endless subject. It's just a mixture of things. So I'm making these lanterns and things right now. It didn't feel good. And I worked for 2 days straight. And I finally felt like I made a piece or a body of work. And I still try to go to that same place when I'm working now where I can put that energy in. So to answer your question, I get rest and I get ready for a moment, that moment to happen again. So.
I have a question. I don't know him.
Yes, you do.
Thank you, dear.
Oh, here we go. You're going to give me a hard time.
No, I won't. I promise. I'm on my best behavior. Really, okay. I am. I think the three of you should have your own TV show, though. I think that would be really cute. The work with the donkeys
right.
that we saw towards the end, and the music stand, mm-hmm. and the lanterns.
Mm-hmm.
So the work for me moves back and forth between things that are found
mm-hmm.
and things that are fabricated.
Right, right.
So how do you decide, like, instead of just using an actual music stand, how do you decide that you need to fabricate one? And with the donkeys, you know, there's a lot of artists doing things with taxidermy and things like that
right,
now.
Right, right.
So how do you decide that you need to fabricate something? How do you make those material kinds of choices?
Right. My favorite place to go is my favorite thing I like to do is go antique shopping. And there's an antique fair that comes second weekend of every month. It's like, you know, what the library is for some people. And a part of it is going and antiquing, is like going and smelling these old objects, and it's like going back in time. And so for me, that's a combination of that. So that stand was an antique that I actually collected, but I didn't know what to do with it. The donkey I've been watching for years as I'm going down these little small towns and I see these little donkeys in the yard. And I kept thinking, like, what am I going to do with that donkey? and I think what it is that every subject and everything I'm trying to take through every part and every body and ways in which I work. So it's like, you know, instead of thinking, let's think about a subject matter. It's like you touch that subject matter. For me, it's like endless. It's like a donkey, the mule, the plow handle. I'm going to come back to it again. And so I keep going over and over. And I think, I think at the end of the day, hopefully I'd created a body of work that was so different. Everything was so different, but connected. So right now, it's like I could take different parts of my work from different times and put it together and make something where it's like I have a show and not a seven different people. And I've always wanted to say, if I had seven different people in me, and I could work seven different ways, and I can have seven different types of income.
Again, I'm going to say that I loved your work. It's the first time I'm seeing you. I'm also from RCC with the Images of Black Americans class. So my question is, in this exhibition, I see Africa and things related to the slave trade. I wanted to know, one, if that's a reoccurring theme in any of your other works. And also, as a visual artist and a black male, has it been difficult to maybe shop work that is so heavily connected to the slave trade?
Okay, I'll answer that one too. The first one, the subject matter, I think it's just important. I think it's like, it's the history of all people. It's the history of human beings. And I think slavery is a short time period in the existence of a people. But I also feel like I have to do that for certain reasons. Some of the reasons have a lot to do with like me being able to talk to my kids, or me being able to just talk to
people. And I think about, you know what, sometimes I put in my mind when I'm making work, it's like, let's say if the average man didn't read and didn't know the King's English and just thought about the world in a different way. I'm more interested in communicating in that very basic way, but very complex. And I think about signs and symbols and things around the world. As I deal with the subject matter, I'm also dealing with my interest in different African practices and what they mean and how they relate to someone in Peru, how they relate to someone anywhere. And there's a certain way in which people are common and communicating talking about up there, you know, and they're fascinated with all these things. As I deal with the subject matter, that's how I combat the pains, because I think about the beauties of it. And I'm fascinated with that kind of stuff. So.
Can I also interject that, you know, the question came up when the show opened in Atlanta, and I was thinking about what it was like to show that work in Atlanta and what it was like to show the work here at Wellesley, and thinking about little kids who come to the museum and how you talk about slavery with little kids, that's heavy. And what I realized in Atlanta is that all these little kids were finding their way into the work in totally magically, because they were seeing things, hidden things, letters and numbers. They were finding objects hidden in the work that meant that they were reading this work on an entirely different level. And it struck me that that was what was magical, was the ability, the work's expansiveness, the work's openness, that's singular. That's about Radcliffe.
I want to just quickly say that RCC means Roxbury Community College.
Thank you.
I'm the instructor. I'm also an alum of Wellesley College, class of 95.
Oh, yeah. Oh yeah, I do.
Okay.
I do, but I do in terms of, I tell you how I do. I used to have a relationship with hip hop groups, and then also like with my cousin worked in the music industry, and I think that one of my earliest parts when I was in school, I was always trying to figure out how to connect all these things. Connect the dots. And I think that, you know, you look at like someone and they're gone and their parents' music, and they pull out this old James Brown album and they pull out this old album and they put these things together. In terms of that part and improvisation of that part, that's heavy to me in my work. It's about making those, it's not as obvious and literal, but it's very much there. Because when I think about the music itself, I think about its connections between jazz, I think about its connections between the blues. I see some parts of it that may be even negative. And I even think that that's connected to the blues, because they have to work out their issues in some form. And guess what? The rhythm itself is beautiful. The pain is real. The confusion can be real. And that's kind of like, even in my own work, I throw it out there, but I don't, it looks different. And the first, one of my first relationships was a hip-hop music stuff. There was this group called Arrested Development.
Yeah.
Right, so in the music video, you see this guy drawing a picture of a lynching? That was me. So that's kind of like some of that. I hate to talk about it. Because I don't, you know, when it happened, I was like, no, don't let my friends see this video. They're going to laugh at me.
While the show was on view at the High, Radcliffe recommended his favorite DJs, and we had a whole evening in the museum's atrium with 2,000 people dancing till midnight. We tried to get the security to let us stay longer, but then we carried on elsewhere. You should see Radcliffe on the dance floor. He's like a sailboat.
So I know the students have really enjoyed your exhibit so far, and it seems like it's definitely an Atlantic narrative. Do you also consider it to be an American narrative?
You said Atlantic?
Atlantic, like crossing between.
Yeah.
So do you also consider it to be an American narrative, like an American story?
I think of it, yes. Yes and no. It's like trying to use something that recognizable and it's old and presence is subject matter. Hey, he's African American. But it's also about, I keep coming back to this whole thing about human, making it where it connects to, like take for instance, you see the old photographs and a lot of times people have the assumption that they're all from the South. No, they're my Northern family members. But then at the same time, they migrated from the South to the North. But then I have family members who didn't migrate from the South to the North, but actually came to the North by a different way. There's a connection, a question about Africa, but I'm interested in even beyond Africa. I'm interested in where people talk about going into these other worlds that, you know, you hear about. They talk about it, you know, with those in Egypt, they talk about Machu Picchu, they talk about the Dogon talk about a particular way, but people in general, they talk about this other place. Mm-hmm. And I think that other place sometimes is just a different state of mind that transforms. Sometimes I believe I live in my dreams, catch hell, and I flip it and I'm trying to take that surreal dream and make it real within my work. And so I think sometimes we think about death and things that happen and we see these things and I think in some strange world that I'll live forever.
Wow. High five on that one.
But I think about it and part of it is that, you know, family and people that come before you, people still live, you know. I think about all that. We're all connected. I think that we're still existing.
Yeah.
I think that some of the things I always think like this too. It's like one of the issues, I hate my dad, we laugh about it all the time, but I think that one of the problems, the issues in the world is that there's so many men in control. I hate, but you know, I'm one. But you know, I think that... I think it's more so the male ego, and then one thing I learned about the Mende women, and they control the society, and I start thinking like my mom, and I start thinking like, oh, that's what's right, okay. but I also think that conflict and things like that can be solved. Women know how to solve those conflicts, but when the problem comes is when men come in and want to take control. So I, okay.
Three more conversations or questions in the room. So, yes. Should we start over here? We'll get over there, and there's the stop as well. But I think you've been waiting. You probably know. We'll get you.
Hello, my name is Dana, and I just wanted to ask, during the beginning of the presentation, you said art for you was hiding from your inadequacies. Insecurities, my fault.
Okay.
Sorry, that's my fault.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to know, with you said memories as medicine was very personal for you.
Right.
So I wanted to know what inadequacy... insecurities. I don't know why I keep saying that. Insecurities you address through either personal memory or collective memory.
Both. You know, there's a lot of, every day, it's like, I think about things in
I think we all think about things in a different way. I think sometimes
I'm Lisa Fishman. I'm director of the Davis Museum. I'm so pleased to see you all here. Welcome to Wellesley. We have the great pleasure today of spending some time with Radcliffe Bailey and with the curator of the exhibition, Carol Thompson. We're going to have a little bit of an unusual format. So first, we're going to ask Radcliffe to speak about his work, and then we're going to gather together to have a little bit more of an open conversation, during which time we'll have questions. It's a really huge treat to have Radcliffe here again, in part because he's been spending some time in the studio working on a lithograph in advance of a program that we have this Saturday called French and American Lithography, History and Practice. It's a day-long symposium. We're going to be working with our partners at the American Antiquarian Society to bring new scholarship and new attention to the long history of French and American relationship around lithography. And Radcliffe has generously spent some time working in the studio on a lithostone so that we have a contemporary tie-in to a more historical program that we have planned. There'll be a demo in the afternoon and all sorts of talks, and it should be a very lively, very fun, very interesting day. So I'll encourage you to pick up one of these programs that are over in the lobby of the Davis Museum after our evening here. The exhibition catalog that accompanies this work, Radcliffe Bailey, Memory as Medicine, is a gorgeous, beautifully illustrated, beautifully written publication. But what it doesn't give so much is the sense of the artist's own voice. And again, we are very lucky to have Radcliffe here with us. It's an incredibly special thing to spend time with an artist around the production and execution of an exhibition, but to have a little extra time once the show is up and people have seen it and it's kind of settled into its place. Well, it's really been a very nice couple of days. So I hope you will join me in welcoming Radcliffe Bailey, in thanking all of our sponsors who've made this exhibition possible, including the Friends of Art, who are so generous in terms of their support for the Davis. And here I will. There we go. Welcome, Radcliffe Bailey.
I've known Lisa probably, how many years have we known each other? For a minute. And it's always nice to be able to work with friends, especially when you're working with something that's personal to you. I think as an artist myself, I think I started making art because of my insecurities. And I've always felt as if I could hide behind my work. And today, it's like, it's weird because I'm doing my work, but now I have to speak in front of people. I hate it. I hate it, but I have to learn to like it, and I love it. These are photographs that were given to me by my grandmother. And my grandmother gave them to me, I guess, I remember I was in college, and I was trying to figure out direction with my work and trying to find a direction, something that made sense to me. And I didn't really know exactly which way to go, but my grandmother, I remember one Christmas, my grandmother, my mom, her sisters, they were all sitting at the table. It was late at night, and basically they traveled from New Jersey to Virginia, and we traveled from Atlanta to Virginia. And basically my grandmother, well, I would sit at the table as a kid and doodle. My grandmother went in the back and she pulled out this old album and she gave it to me. But the thing about it, my grandmother didn't really know my work. But she gave it to me at a moment when I was at somewhat of a crossroads between trying to figure out directions with my work. And so what I decided was to honor those images of those family members. One of the reasons why it's interesting, go to antique markets and flea markets and see these old photographs. And these old photographs would become discarded. People would buy them. You never know much about them. So we had these old photographs. We had close to maybe 400 photographs in this album. And these are a few of some of the tintypes and some of the things I actually started working with in my work. So I choose to use the ones that we didn't know anything about. Part of the reason why is because they would become discarded. And I use the images, and sometimes the images become like deities to me. You know, there's see some images of females and they have a strong image that relate to different. I'm gonna go ahead and move on a little. So this is an image of my studio. I kind of work on maybe 20 or 30 things at one time. And you know, I never know when to stop. I choose to stop on the seventh layer. And sometimes it's the seven actual physical layers, or sometimes it's actual seven layers of thought. And so I kind of play back and forth. Seven, why seven? Because I felt like it was a perfect number. But basically, I didn't really study painting when I was in school. I was a sculpture major. And so I only started painting after school because it was easier to move a painting and then to sell a big piece of sculpture. And when I was in school, I was working with different, I was actually working with sound, just different types of objects. And I was doing basically what you do in school is push yourself to a limit. You go out and you get lost in your work. So this is another close up. Oh, it's okay. No. So you can kind of see, like in the studio, I'm leaving stuff on the ground, and part of it is trying to leave traces and show tracks in terms of my direction, so that tomorrow when I get up, I can start back at it. So, like, I'll give you an example of a layer for me. A layer would be like, there's that funny-looking, mini-looking green that's on the painting. That green was, what I remember from that green was that my grandfather and my grandmother, I spend those summers and those breaks with them. My grandmother allowed my grandfather to have this one room in the house. This one room in the house, which was his room where he made things. And my grandfather made birdhouses, and he would always say the birds will tell you when the weather changes, and people will too. And so what I did was, whenever I use that mint green, it's a reference to my grandfather. So that's like a layer for me. This is another view of the studio. Yeah, those are my dreadlocks on the paper. I was making paintbrushes out of my dreadlocks at one time. And that's a photograph in the background. It's a photograph that is of a tobacco field where on my grandfather's side of family, they sharecropped Virginia. And that was a photograph that was taken by my grandfather. And that painting in the back is called Uncured Labor. All right, so that was my studio then. That's my studio now. And in the studio now, I just thought I'd try something different and show an image of something recent. But that's a music stand, and it's 10 feet high. So, and it's all about, you know, I've been working with these ideals of music and musicians, as musicians is almost like reference to gods. And you know, when I was in college, I had an opportunity to see Sun Ra. And I saw Sun Ra perform like maybe three or four times. And I was just blown away when Sun Ra would perform and he would come in late and say that the time on this planet was wrong. And I thought he was an interesting person. So this is a piece called Birmingham the Magic City. And he said he was from Saturn, but he was actually from Birmingham. And so Birmingham the Magic City is a play on, you know, words and magic, perceptions of a black cat to be negative, and these practices in West Africa said to be negative, but I always took them in a positive way. It has BBB on the doors, which is referred to Birmingham Black Barons, which was my first passion, which was baseball. The holes that are drilled along the door refer to this church that's in Savannah, Georgia, was during the Underground Railroad, they were hiding some of the runaway slaves up under the church, and basically for ventilation of the church, because the church was so cool. I mean, to cool the church in the basement was that they drilled holes, and then holes in these kind of crossroad patterns. And I'm showing some older work, but I'll get to newer work. This is called, this is based on the Birmingham church bombing. And I was commissioned, I wasn't commissioned, I was part of a show that was dealing with the civil rights movement, and this was like 93. And I was doing stuff about the Deacons for Justice and Defense who protected the church by any means with the shotguns. And basically I learned about the incident, and it's not through history books, but I learned about the incident through John Coltrane's music. He had a piece called Birmingham, and it had an effect on me. So I played the song over and over, and I put it on a loop. And so what you hear when you walk in the space was the loop of that sound. So I made a piece out of fire hoses. And so there are fire hoses that run around, but the fire hoses deal with those things used against people, but also the fire hoses for me was representing in another positive light in terms of women and female goddesses and water goddesses. And so I'm using the blue, and blue referred to the blues, but it also refers to the ocean, but different deities. It smells like honey when you come up to the piece, because the piece is painted with encaustic too. And basically I collected materials from, there was this house that was burnt down for a reason because they didn't want these people to move into the neighborhood. So basically I collected the materials from this particular house and made this piece. And it's like the church pews were dealing with church in a way. So people, sometimes people come and sit down and meditate. But also like it sits on railroad tracks, and it was dealing with the divide between people. This is called Oceanic Beloved, and I'll show some of these images. This was based on my mother being a school teacher and carrying the weight of a lot of kids on top of her. And it's also, in some parts of it, references different parts of West Africa that my curiosity was trying to figure out exactly what part of my DNA, where does it trace to? Because that's something, as an artist, I've always been like curious about in terms of mark making and interest. So there's other things that are in it I won't talk about because I got to get through these. This one's called Mingus Mingus, and it was based on Charles Mingus. And I was thinking if Mingus played baseball, he would play catcher. And so he's this bigger guy, and he's behind home plate. And so basically you have a home plate down at the bottom, and home plate represents to me, that was the position I played when I was in catcher. When I played baseball after school, I played catcher. But during the day, I was in class, and I was sitting back to class because I didn't want to go up to the chalkboard. And so I played back and forth between the jazz musicians and the chitlin circuit and the ball players and how they had these relationships. And the neck, the upright, the long neck on it is made out of plow handles based on 40 acres and a mule. Oh, this one's based on Jimi Hendrix, an idea where Jimi Hendrix was putting his guitar on fire. And then it also refers to Lightning Hopkins. There was this house in the fourth ward in Houston where I did an installation with this project called Project Row House. And when I went and did the project, there were all these doors laying around, and basically they sent me maybe 30, 40 doors, and I started rebuilding and constructing the doors in different ways. And the idea was like, you know how Jimi Hendrix puts his guitar on fire, but then also one of the houses there was actually owned by Lightning Hopkins. And so it refers to those blues musicians. Blues musicians talk about crossroads, a house as a place crossing through the door of a crossroads. I did 9 of these paintings, and they're about like 80, 90 inches by 90 or something like that. And I did it on my firstborn, my daughter, when she was born. And I basically took African art and photographed it as if she was coming out of the womb. And so this refers to that, but then also, it's very random. But I think for me, painting is like playing chess. I love to lose because I get more out of losing than I do winning. And so I create problems to solve with on the paintings themselves. So I don't put together colors that make sense sometimes, like this one.